Hello, I'm Eric Holdeman, and this is Disaster Zone, a show about emergencies and disasters that can happen anywhere and at any time. Today's show is with Barb Graff, Director for the Office of Emergency Management for the City of Seattle. And the subject for this program is Emergency Management and Homeland Security, how the profession has developed over the years, changes we've seen in focus, and then, of course, we're going to talk about hazards, disasters, and then the future. So, Barb, thanks for being here on the show.
It's great to be here.
You're back. There you go. And, you know, emergencies. When's our last big disaster we had? I don't know. Maybe the snow? Yeah, a few years back or so. But a lot of folks might not know a lot about you. That we've known one another for over 20 years, and you have a strong background in emergency management. How about share, you know, what positions you've had and where?
You bet. In 1989, the Loma Prieta earthquake in California really shook a lot of local programs out of complacency and made people realize, you know, that kind of earthquake could happen here in the Pacific Northwest. And so a lot of cities and counties really started to beef up or create from scratch emergency management programs. That was when the city of Bellevue created an emergency management program. And so I cut my teeth in emergency management for the city of Bellevue and was their director of their program for about 15 years. And then almost 9 years ago, moved from Bellevue to City of Seattle, where I'm doing the same thing. So I oversee the Office of Emergency Management, which, although housed within our police department, is responsible for all phases of emergency management, mitigation, preparedness, response, and recovery for the whole city. How do we achieve unity of effort in all the things that we do in emergency management? I also had the pleasure, while I was still with Bellevue, of having the city serve as a pilot for the National Emergency Management Accreditation Program. And that's a system whereby there's a set of standards that say you've studied your hazards, you educate your public, you plan, you train, you exercise, and you do a self-assessment first to say, do I think I've done all these things adequately? And then you need to prove it through documentation. At the end of that whole process, a team of assessors from around the nation come in and take a look at your documentation. They interview your staff and determine whether or not you actually are in compliance with the standards. I've been associated with that Emergency Management Accreditation Program ever since. And so currently I'm very, very honored to chair the EMAP Accreditation Program Commission, as well as the Program Review Committee.
Okay, and that commission has to have a home. Where's its home?
Lexington, Kentucky.
And as part of,
It's housed in the same building where the Council on State Government is housed, which is also where they house the staff for the National Emergency Management Association.
Okay, very good. And you know, I'm glad you talked about that national picture, and I think maybe later on, next question we're going to talk about relationships. But really now, you're the senior leader of the larger county cities in Washington State. You've been around long enough, and we're in a period of transition. So it's great to see you providing leadership not only nationally, but I think you also provide it here within the state.
I appreciate it. And that was a nice way of saying you're getting older. You haven't yet been voted off the island.
We have a lot of experience, Barb.
It's been an interesting career in emergency management. You, for a long time, were one of my mentors. You were a trusted colleague and friend, still are. But yeah, I've seen a lot of people come and go in emergency management. It used to be, when I started in this profession, it was impossible to get a degree in Homeland Security or emergency management. And now there's close to 300 colleges and universities that offer a degree.
Yeah.
It used to be that if you took training in emergency management courses from FEMA's Emergency Management Institute, you had to attend usually a week-long course or 3.5 or 4 days. And you really met your colleagues in emergency management. So there was an alumni class of us. I consider you to be one of those.
Yep.
Who got together and really got to know each other when we talked about how do you plan for emergencies? What does a sustained operation in an emergency operations center look like? How do you use volunteers and finance your program and such? And these last couple of years have been bittersweet as I've watched more people retire and I realize, oh, that's right, you guys have 25 years experience in this as well.
And, you know, it's interesting. I've been thinking about this. I was in Oregon last week at Oregon State Office of Emergency Management there. And Kelly Jo, I can't remember Kelly.
Oh, right. Hanson?
Maybe. But she was instructor for our professional development series that you and I went through. But then you're talking about the relationships. Diane Newman went through that series, Neil Clemen. And still we're tied together, grounded from those relationships built over 20 years ago.
That's right. Yeah.
I congratulate Kelly Jo on the birth of her child who's now 20.
How timely. This kind of leads to another point that I think we're going to talk about later, having to do with mutual aid relationships and doing emergency management in different ways. Back then, because the state of Washington didn't have the budget necessary to put on a full-fledged training and exercise program, you and I went through the professional development series in Oregon because Oregon offered that neighborly service to Washington. And I think in the future, we're going to see, I hope, that we see more collaboration like that in how we go about helping each other out with the basics.
Yeah, I think you're right on the money. I'd have to correct you, though. While you're organizationally in the police department, you're housed in the fire station.
That is an interesting conundrum, isn't it?
So you're actually in a fire station, a modern facility.
And I should get quick history to that. Our former mayor, Mayor Nichols, was very inspired by the 1995 Kobe, Japan earthquake. And he saw that red tile roofs collapsed buildings and too much development on narrowing streets don't let fire engines get down them. And underground water cisterns will break and they won't be there for you after the earthquake. So he came home and he helped the voters pass a levy in 2003 that built our new and present Emergency Operations Center from scratch. Co-housed in that facility is our fire alarm center, 24/7 operation, and we share a common wall with Fire Station 10, which is our hazardous material unit.
Okay, so a lot of integration right there in the city of Seattle. So, you know, with the pretty rapid in the last year, we've had four senior directors change positions. You know, what's that mean to people, a lot of institutional knowledge, you know, moving out the positions, other people moving up, taking over?
Not to sound too old, but this is what we do. I always like to look back to one of my very favorite people in emergency management from State of Washington Emergency Management Division, Joel Aggregard. Yeah. Their current Emergency Operations Center is actually named after him. Yeah. There's a plaque on the wall for him. And one of the reasons so many of us trusted and revered him was that he always said, the best lessons are already in your DNA. You just need to talk more with one another. And so people who experience wildfires and floods on a frequent basis in eastern Washington have a lot to teach those of us who deal with acts of terrorism or earthquakes on the west side, and vice versa. And it's good that we learn lessons from one another and how to help each other out. There has been, you're right, a lot of churn in leadership, and the difficulty is sometimes you only get a presidentially declared disaster once every couple of years, and if you have too much churn in all of your staff, you don't have the knowledge of, you have the academic, you know, here's what we think this is going to be like, but you don't have in your muscle memory, what was it really like when we had to deal with people? It's a very different exercise, reality, from the academic experience of it. The good thing in all the churn is you also get new ideas and fresh perspectives, and that's always good for all of us.
Yeah. Okay. And people have asked me all the time, but I say, well, they ask, what do you do? Maybe on a plane or somewhere. And I say, well, I'm in emergency management. I do disasters. And they say, oh, you work for FEMA. Uh-huh. And I said, well, not really. I try and explain there's these different levels of emergency management that it exists at the federal level. FEMA, the state has an office, the county has an office, cities have an office. You know, a lot of people don't understand, why do you have all these levels of emergency management?
I answer that question so I don't necessarily get associated with the wrong agency as saying, what I do for a living is I plan for your worst day. So
that's not a bad quote.
That's a really good question about why would the city of Seattle need an emergency management program? Because King County has one. Why does King County need a program? Because the state of Washington has one, et cetera. But if you think about it, the whole reason we have different levels of government is we all offer different levels and types of services. So King County has fire districts, but no fire department. Cities do. state of Washington collects taxes that are distributed, B&O taxes and others that are distributed throughout the state. The locals don't do that. Jails, sewage treatment, all kinds of services are offered at different levels of government. In a disaster, the disaster couldn't care less who owns and operates the service. It's going to pick on all of us. But we all need to have a planning together to say, how are we going to integrate with one another? A great example of this from the early 70s was fire departments who just did fire suppression, basically, in Southern California and wound up creating the incident command system so they would have a common terminology and an understanding of tactics and span of control and everything else. When we do emergency management planning at the local level, we're planning in concert with businesses, some of whom do logistics a whole lot better than we do. Give me UPS or FedEx or even Target, who do this on a daily basis. But I need to coordinate with county because I also have neighboring cities. And I don't have the time to reach out to all 38 of them. I need to work with the county on things like that. Like I said, different services like wastewater treatment, jail service, bus service. We all need to have a plan about how the services we're responsible for tie together in an emergency.
Okay. We had a couple minutes left before the break, and I'd say, you know, during the last two decades that we've been in the business, there have been, pardon the pun, seismic shifts in emergency management. It's really undergone a lot of transformation there. How would you describe that journey up until now? Maybe we'll talk about the future when we come back.
I have always been an all hazards gal, and I've really loved what I learned about integrated emergency management, having to do with that is hazard agnostic and consequence specific. But we have seen the way attention and money gets focused on whatever the biggest disaster is. So September 11th, 2001, the pendulum swung to terrorism. We're going to spend a lot of time and money, a lot of time and money on terrorism. 2005, Katrina. We're going to spend a lot of time and money on improving our response to hurricanes. And so I guess what I've seen the most of is, and the people I trust the most and do the best work with are those who realize that's just a cycle. And the pendulum will swing back again, and eventually we will hit all hazards.
Okay, where are we in that cycle now, you think?
I think we've achieved the best balance we've ever seen at the moment. The Boston bombings remind us that terrorism is an ever-evolving threat, and the tactics won't be the same from one to another. We still live in the shadow of Superstorm Sandy, where FEMA tried brand new things they'd never tried before, as well as New York City and state of New Jersey. And those of us on the West Coast can't get out of our mind the cascading effects of a Japanese earthquake, tsunami, and nuclear power plant devastation that completely overshadowed the fact they had two broken dams at exactly the same time. I think we're in the middle of the pendulum swinging right now.
Okay. Hopefully it isn't the pit and the pendulum. I remember the old movie on that. Whoever Poe was, Edgar Allan Poe.
That's right.
I think it was a book or short story. Well, listen, this has been great, Barb, and we're going to take a quick break right now. And when we come back, we'll be talking more about emergency management in general, the future, kind of picking up where we just left off, and the City of Seattle's program in particular. So stay tuned. We'll be right back.
In the event of a catastrophe, you need to know what to do to make it through. By preparing now, you and your family will have a better chance of surviving when a catastrophe happens. Here are three tips to get you started. Have an emergency plan with meeting places and an out-of-area contact. Prepare a supply kit for your family and pets that includes what you need to survive for 7 to 10 days. And be prepared to help each other. Start now and take the first step to protect the ones you love. For more information, visit makeitthrough.org or find us on Facebook.
Hi, I'm Eric Holdeman, and this is Disaster Zone. And if you're just joining us for our program today, my guest is Barb Graff, the director for the Seattle Office of Emergency Management. And we've been talking about emergency management in general, and we're going to turn our attention to also the City of Seattle in this second half. And thanks, Barb, for being
on the show.
Pleasure
being here.
So we were talking early in the first half of the show, kind of where the profession's been in that. How do you see the overall status of emergency management in the nation today for government, business, nonprofit?
I think we have grown into an awareness that government can't solve all the problems of mitigating, lessening the impact of disasters, of doing all of the preparedness, of adequately responding to catastrophic level things, and then adequately recovering. So I think we're in an interesting new time, and certainly I think under Craig Fugate's leadership at FEMA, we're seeing a much more welcome stance about inviting the private sector, local citizens, clubs, groups, whoever can get engaged to help out. Joplin, Missouri was an interesting case in point where I believe they reconstructed a high school in 54 days. And you can't do that if you're just the government. You can't do that if you're just the PTA. You can only pull that kind of thing off if you've got an engaged team working on something like that.
Yeah. Although I think they put in a different building. They didn't rebuild the actual high school, I think.
Very, very possible.
But they had the summer to do it, which was great.
Right. But everyone basically said, yeah, it's critical for us to get kids back in school as soon as it's supposed to open. And that's how they pulled it off.
Okay. So the Federal Emergency Management Agency, since I don't think I used that acronym earlier myself, or name to describe it, Craig Fugate says whole community. Mm-hmm. You like a different term.
I don't know if I've settled on just one term, but I'm a fan of what he's trying to get at. And that is that there's a lot of resources and services you can use in your local community if you just give it some thought. I'm going to give a lot of credit to our fire department, who years ago realized that when they have to do collapse rescue, structural collapse rescue, they knew that they would be calling on skilled labor unions and trade associations who operate heavy equipment. And so rather than waiting to exchange business cards the day that a building collapses, they invited them in and showed them their operating procedures and practice with one another constantly now about how they would deliver that type of service.
Don't you call it community engagement or something like that?
No? That's a good thing.
Okay, yeah, all right. You don't disagree with that.
Yeah, but the idea is there are a lot of people in our community who on a daily basis know how to access what they need in government. And that's great, but what about the immigrant and refugee community who may not trust the fact that you're government simply because you're government? Right. What about the 192 languages spoken in the Seattle school system? Are we being friendly enough to those folks? Our consulates, we've got people who visit from other countries constantly, so how are we reaching out to make sure that all segments of our community know how to reduce their risks, and then how can they play a vital role in response and recovery?
Okay. Well, we're a hazard-rich environment here in the Pacific Northwest. And so I'm going to go through a list of hazards, have you speak briefly about each one and, you know, the threats that they pose from that standpoint. And one that always gets a lot of attention is earthquakes.
Mm-hmm. Three different types of earthquakes that happen in our area. The most frequent every 20 to 30 years is just long enough for us to think it won't happen again in my lifetime. So that's the hard thing. But some of the worst earthquakes that we experience only happen every couple of hundred years, and we're in that time zone. We're living right now when we could experience something enormous. The complexity of an earthquake is what makes it unique on our list of hazards. It is so enormous in scope. It crumples your infrastructure. It interrupts all of your communication. It requires assistance from all over the nation to help you out at a time when it's hard to get assistance here. It impacts everybody. And I think more so than anything else, it impacts on weak human infrastructure as well as physical infrastructure. So we tend to do most of our training, most of our practice, and almost all of our public education on earthquake. Get ready for an earthquake, we say, and you're ready for almost everything else on the list.
It's really our big catastrophic disaster.
It is, yeah.
Okay. So how about severe weather? And in there we put storms, wind, cold, snow, all their ramifications.
That's the most frequent thing that happens in our area. And so flooding has been the most commonly presidentially declared disaster in Washington State and here in Seattle and King County. Just because it's frequent doesn't mean that we always are perfect at our response. Seattle is a good example of nearly a decade ago choosing to abide by an old policy that said never use salt. And as a result, we're just like Rome, the seven famous hills. And, yes. And it's although it's really, really lovely when the first flakes fall, it goes from charming to alarming really, really fast. And at dusk, it turns to ice almost every single time. When you lose to ice, the battle is over. So storms happen on a frequent basis, whether it's a sustained power outage, whether it's slippery streets because of snow, or whether it's flooding conditions. We need to always improve our response. More and more people are living here all the time and need to be educated about the risk and how to be prepared. And people have shorter and shorter patience and higher expectations of how perfectly we'll be able to restore services. So that's always a challenge for
us. So I'll give you two here that generally are not Seattle-specific hazards, but wildland fires, and I'll throw in volcano.
Okay, so wildland fire, interesting, Washington State, enormous risk, not as much in the urban. The urban interface sometimes poses a problem. And generally, fire departments and districts on the west side of the state really specialize in structural firefight, and fire agencies on the east side of the state tend to specialize in wildland fire. But we help each other out constantly, and so we had many opportunities to send strike teams of firefighting resources to protect structures in eastern Washington while the eastern Washington firefighters are dealing with brush fire and the canyons and things like that. We also had the opportunity, Seattle Emergency Management, to send a couple of staff duty officers to Kittitas County. They'd only activated their EOC once every couple of years, and they'd run like 36 hours straight with no sleep. And so we sent them a couple people just to say, we know how to run emergency operations, get some sleep, let us help. And then we led them into their eventual recovery process.
Okay. Volcano to the immediate south.
We've been very lucky that the most massive volcanic explosion, Mount St. Helens, traveled due east, and Yakima got hit a lot harder than all the rest of us. But it is nonetheless a risk. Yeah. I think they consider volcanoes, if there's been activity in the last 10,000 years, they're active.
Yes, right. So Mount Rainier is an active volcano. And what happens in Pierce County matters to King County.
It does. And
the city of Seattle.
Absolutely. Pierce County very concerned about protecting their population, and it may well be that one way to protect is if there's more seismic activity and some indicators, maybe asking people to relocate someplace, and we could be one of those places.
Okay. Terrorism, we mentioned it earlier.
Terrorism is the evolving threat, and that's a tough one, because no act of terrorism is ever going to look exactly like the last one, which is not to say that every earthquake looks like the last one either. But this is an intentional asymmetric warfare. So we find a way to harden a structure or protect a facility or
take off your shoes when you get on the plane.
Do something that makes us safer. And then the terrorists study that and find out, oh, that's what you're doing. And so we'll come up with a new tactic. So it's a constant dance between protection and intention. And so that makes terrorism something that we always have to pay attention to and plan hard for.
Okay. And we'll run through these next ones pretty quick. Cybersecurity.
You got to read Richard Clark's book, Cyber War. We are so dependent on our computing devices for everything, for telemetry, for hospital systems, and they're getting easier and easier. And I shouldn't say they're easier to hack. It's becoming more prevalent that a rupture someplace in the system is going to have cascading effects.
Yeah. Pandemic diseases, not just flu, but others.
Yeah. In 2005, we were reminded that H5N1 was just around the corner and could have resembled the 1918
flu.
worldwide Spanish flu. And so we did a lot of planning for that. The difficulty on that one is many of the other disasters you listed kind of pick on the young and the old. And pandemic influenza really, or other diseases have a tendency to pick on young working adult age. So imagine a lot of people who are air traffic controllers and nurses and daycare providers and things. And so that has a unique twist in how we plan for that.
Okay. And I have written down climate change, but I'll reterm that climate variability. Mm-hmm. It's just getting warmer. Forget whether it's carbon-based or not.
I meet with my counterparts in 16 of the nation's biggest cities a couple times a year, and we share best practices and lessons and help shape national policy. And that's come up on our list repeatedly. Between 60 and 70% of the American population now lives in urban areas, and the predominance of those are in coastal communities. So this needs to be a national focus, and we're blessed in Seattle that we have an Office of Sustainability and Environment who's helping to shape and contribute to that national dialogue. They talk with 40 other cities globally about what we can do to better prepare for those things we can't prevent.
Okay. And thanks for running through that list. How about talking about some of the priority projects your office is working on now, and why did you pick those priorities?
We have for years and years had an emergency response plan in place, which is not that hard to design, and we practice it on a regular basis. But because we spend so much time on it, using it in exercises and authentic events, we give short shrift to the whole recovery period. And especially after an earthquake, it can take years, it can take decades to regain a sense of normalcy. Look at Christchurch, New Zealand right now. We finally, thanks to the good graces of our elected officials, got funded to actually put together both a recovery plan, a guidebook to help steer our actions, as well as a concept of who needs to be doing what, whether it's a policy level group kind of giving vision, or planners that need to talk about, is this an opportunity to fix things in current code that just continue disasters and things. So recovery planning is huge.
Okay. And it's hard to believe, but we're down to 2 minutes.
Oh.
I can't believe it. I think the clock must be moving fast. So I'm going to pick on one other piece, and I know that was there, but of anybody working in emergency management, you've done a wonderful job working with the elected officials, and you've done number setting. So
thanks.
Very briefly, in about a minute.
Yeah.
What do you think is key to making that
effective? I have worked with a lot of elected officials, both in a strong mayor form of government as well as a council manager form of government. And what I've learned throughout all of them, everyone has their eccentricities, but you don't go to the time and expense and trouble to get yourself elected unless you really, really care about people where they live. I think the key for emergency management is to find out where is that concern, whether it's mitigation, whether it's response planning, a sense of security, fairness and equity for everyone who lives in your community, and then appeal to that sense. It resides in every single elected official I've ever worked with. The key is align what you know must happen in emergency management with how you know they care about their community.
Okay. Well, listen, we're out of time. It's hard to believe we didn't get through all our questions. Maybe, Barb, we can have you back in a year, and we'll go deeper into some of these other topics. I want to thank you for being on the program. The Disaster Zone coffee mug is for yours to take with you as a remembrance. If we do another show, bring it back with you. I'm not giving you a second cup. So, again, thanks for being on the show.
Pleasure, Eric.
All right. And this brings us to the end of our show for today. Thanks for tuning in and learning more about what you and others can do to become better prepared for disasters. And remember, if you're going to get prepared, today is a good day to start. Have a great day, and tune in again soon. Bye-bye.